all kinds of people. That's what he likes to do. He's really interested in the political arena and especially the Chinese and what's going on in the whole world. There you go. Is that your only son?
No, I have three kids.
Three? God. Three kids. I had one son, Trevor. And Trevor is 32. He's got three kids. And he's a minister, Knoxville, First Baptist Concord. And I have a daughter. And Trevor's married to Erica. And I have a daughter as a PA in neurology.
In Cleveland?
In Arkansas, Fayetteville. And she's married to a minister. And then Riley works for the Senate for Hagerty, and just got married yesterday. Last night.
I saw that on Facebook.
Drove in.
You drove in just for the discussion.
Just for fellowship with my friend.
And we are glad.
Well, I'm blessed. And got three great kids, great wife, 35 years of marriage this coming December.
Y'all ever argue?
All the time. But she's a great balancer of me. She takes care of me, you know.
You know, if you don't argue, you're probably not communicating. Would you agree with that?
You know, communication is speaking and listening. Uh-huh. And sometimes somebody be speaking, but if someone's not listening, communication is not taking place. And in my opinion.
If we told everybody all of our thoughts, we can't, can we?
Well, no.
I mean, because
sometimes we need
curb.
It's like my daddy used to tell me. You know, my mom liked to talk and have a good time. My dad was a quiet man. You remember my dad? Quiet man. And so my dad used to tell me, he said, you got two ears and one mouth. Son, you might want to keep your mouth shut every now and then and listen. Don't tell everything's on your mind all the time. So, it's all good.
How old was you when your dad passed away?
I was senior in high school. And my dad was 49 years old. My mom was 45.
Your dad coached Little League?
Forever.
I remember.
Astros. When I was David Swalford, myself. Dale Swalford, Odell Swalford, was my dad's assistant. And
I remember that like it was yesterday.
I'm telling you, we lived life at Fulbright Park playing cup ball.
Cup ball. Yeah. In the center.
Yes, sir. Cup ball. Cup ball. And
in the center.
Mm-hmm. And then watching and getting foul balls.
Foul balls.
Because we didn't have any money. We get foul balls to get us a...
Hey, they would race for those foul balls.
Yes.
I mean, it was a race.
You know, we get those, all the flavors together.
Yeah.
Suicide. That's right.
Suicide.
It's a suicide. And, you know, just.
What team was you on? Were you on Coach Palmer's T-ball first?
No, sir. My dad was my first coach. But Dole taught me. He is so funny because Mr. Palmer, my dad said, you need to go, Mr. Palmer, he's going to teach you how to hit.
Mr. Palmer.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And this, he says, son, we're going to hit off the tee today. Hey, we spent a lot
He's still
of,
alive.
Oh, we spent a lot of our time hitting off the tee. And a lot of kids today, they don't want to hit off the tee.
Yeah.
And it's funny to me, most of your pro teams, they start hitting off the tee and they don't quit on hitting off the tee. But parents want to put their kids in a coach pitch and a player pitch so quick, they don't learn how, I don't think they learn how to quit.
How to swing. Got to swing first.
Groove that swing, yes, sir.
But was that, so you weren't on, did you not sign up for the, what was that, Little League?
No, what happened was, you know, we had the minor leagues, which was the 5, 6, and 7, and then they had the 8, 9 little, and then 10 to 12, and then they had the Pony League. Remember they had the Pony League?
I was in the Pony League.
Remember,
I was on the Angels.
The Steve Benton and Earl Rowan coached that all-star team forever at the 13, 14-year-old team. I remember we went to Florida, and I was in the American League, and they were in the National League, so I didn't get to go, but they went and played the World Series. We thought that was the biggest thing in Cleveland.
Oh, yeah.
Remember, Corky went down there.
Corky went live.
And did it on the radio.
The parades. Remember the parades?
That was so much fun. Remember, we used to have the trucks and line up Cleveland. We started.
Oh, it was
the old Village Mall. My grandmother, my mama's mama, worked at Miller's. At Miller's. Remember the old, was it Miller's? Yeah. Miller's.
In the mall.
At the mall.
Miller.
Yeah.
What, she, not Park. There was Park Belts, and then there's Miller's.
Miller's, yeah. Miller's was kind of, we always thought that was
a little upper.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so she
How
did.
How was that?
I don't know. She did perfume and those type things. And so I never forget my grandmother would come out and watch us decorate the truck, my dad's Ford pickup truck. All the boys would hop in the back of the pickup truck. All the teams would go drive all the way through the town like a parade. And then we would end up at Fulbright Park.
Fulbright
and in the
Park,
opening ceremony.
And they all lined up, and Corky would, somebody would pray. Remember, somebody would pray, give the Pledge of Allegiance. Right. And they had like several games that day. Remember, it was several games that day.
They had an opening pitch, opening ceremony. You had all your things, and you had, it was the minor league field, A and B, and the Pony League field.
Mm-hmm.
And they all played, all kind of all afternoon, all evening.
All day.
And
round robins or something like
everybody
that.
Everybody got to play.
Yeah.
And I never forget, that's the first time I ever wore eye black. When they put the eye.
Oh, yeah, underneath.
Yeah. I thought I was something. You know, dude, we put the eye black on.
What teams did you play for first?
I played for the Astros for my dad and the Senators with Zeiss.
Senators, right.
Mr. Zeiss, Mark Zeiss's daddy. Yeah.
Did you wear your hat backwards?
Never. No, sir. No, it was only if you was a catcher. See, in the those days, you have a, now they have the helmet, they have the full gear. We just had the strap on, they pulled over it, that
if
hat.
If it didn't fit, you just made it tighter somehow?
Yeah, over your hat.
Yeah.
No, I would never have worn my hat backwards. In fact,
Mr. Geithner was my coach. You remember him?
Yes, absolutely. I guarantee you.
Mr. Geithner. He was the biggest influence in my life to this day.
Really?
I was on his team for 3 years.
And
he really didn't influence me in any way, I didn't think.
Right.
I was on the Yellow Jackets. I was on the Little League.
Right.
T-ball. Then the Yellow Jackets.
Mm-hmm.
Then Coach Geithner's, which was, and then was the Yankees.
Right.
And then the Angels in the Pony League. And I made the All-Stars every year.
You was a player.
I was a player. I got a trophy for the most home runs.
You know what? In the day, speaking of trophies, they hand them out like candy now.
Hey, it was a big deal to get a trophy.
Yes, sir.
A big deal.
Absolutely.
I mean, it was a big deal.
We won the league as the Astros. And then we won the league as a Senators because we had three left and we had David Swofford and then me and then Dale Swofford. So we had three left-handers. And those three left-handed pitchers really pitched at Bradley for Joe Adams, David.
Right.
And then it was me and then it was Dale.
Did you pitch for them to also?
Absolutely. We, in fact, Coach Adams kind of had three back-to-back, left-handed pitchers.
Yeah.
And then,
remember Tim Dodd?
Do I remember? Lord have mercy.
Nobody remembers him but me and you.
Hey, you had to swing now to catch up to his fastball.
He was one of the best that's ever been.
Absolutely. He had a great fastball.
He was another level.
Well, what happened, I think, at Cleveland High School, you had Teddy Carson. Remember Teddy Carson? Went to Tennessee. Mm-hmm. Then you had Tim Dodd. And they both could throw it like nobody's business.
And Tim Dodd, didn't he go to the Reds?
Yes, sir. Absolutely. And we were great friends. In fact, you know where I lived? I lived over on Vista.
I lived behind him on Norman Chapel.
Could he not? Unbelievable.
And whenever he'd pitch, I always, because I noticed little things, he'd bring his leg up and he'd take the glove and go, like twice.
Cock it. And that ball's coming in a hurry.
He was good.
And
just so fluid.
And just we he and I would have fun together. I was wrestling with whether to go to Cleveland or Bradley because I lived over there behind McDonald's. And Louis offered, Coach Ware, they always want to.
Yeah.
And David Conley and I, you know, Mike Conley, Coach Conley.
Yeah.
He was a little older than David, and he and I were best buddies growing up. In fact, David and I played baseball together. He played for my dad in the Astros, and so we played up all the way through, all up to Pony League. And we and I just wrestled. We're like, we're going to go to Cleveland or Bradley, or what are we going to do? And he went to Cleveland, and I went to Bradley. But became was such good friends. And you remember he died, you know, in a car wreck with Jackie Witts.
Now, John went to Cleveland. Right?
No, my brother went to Bradley, but he was younger. And John,
he was my age.
Yes, John was, and John was a late developer. My brother was just slow as far as.
I never thought of him as slow. I thought, didn't he catch?
No, as far as, not slow like slow, but slow as far as developing in size.
Yeah, he was like my size.
Yeah, he was real short, and all of a sudden, he just, that's what I mean by slow as far as. You know, I grew fast. You know, I was tall and large when I was in middle school, and he was one of the smallest guys. And then all of a sudden, he started growing just a little bit. No, as far as, you know, John was a catcher. John, my brother, is a student of sports. Mm-hmm. He was the last football coach at Charleston High School.
I remember that.
And the first football coach at Walker Valley High School, head coach.
Is he still there?
No, he is. He went
out of town, didn't he?
Yes, he went to Northwest Whitfield and then went to Rome, Georgia, and won several state championships in Rome as an assistant. I always give him a hard time because John's about 5'8", 5'9", and his son, Tyler, my nephew, is 6'4".
Golly, where did he get that
from? He's 6'4", like 280. Where did that come from? I mean, all-state football player in Georgia. I don't know where that came from. I'd have to
tell John I said, hey, because I hadn't seen him since high school, I guess.
John has had a tough time with his back. He was in a car wreck with Scott Sharp when they were right out of
college. Oh, God.
He was in a car wreck with Scott. He got hit head on.
Did Scott die? Is that when Scott died?
No, Scott was severely injured.
Didn't he die?
He died recently. He died about 2 or 3 years ago. But he struggled physically for a while. Great guy. You talking about a great guy.
Him and his brother.
Yes. Todd and Scott, unbelievable.
Smart.
People. Oh, my star. His mama still works at the YMCA.
Oh, really?
I see her all the time at the YMCA. Great.
They were like.
I think it was an engineer or something major.
I don't know, but they were just extremely smart people, the Sharps. I hadn't heard that name in years.
You know what? You and I talk around here long enough, we remember a lot of people.
We're probably related.
I tell people, you know, when I was wrestling with coming back to Cleveland, I didn't want to come back. I said, goodness gracious, God, I don't want to do this. I was over there with Landreth at Long Hollow.
Glenn Ramsey's?
Son-in-law. Played at Bradley.
Right.
Moved here from Arkansas.
That's right.
All-state basketball player.
Married to Glenn's daughter.
Jennifer. Great guy. He and I were best friends in high school. And he went to Cleveland State, played basketball.
How much older are you than me? Like 2 years?
I'm fixed to be 59 in August.
So I'm 56. So just a couple. You say about 3 years. Yeah,
same age as John. And, you know, you think about it, all of what we got to see Cleveland, you've gotten to see Cleveland change a lot. I went around the country. I've been back. This is my third time back. I was here, came back as a youth minister, then left again and came back as my role now at First Baptist. So.
What made you get into the religious order?
When I was a senior in high school, I was wrestling with what God wanted me to do. And Jim Gibson was my youth minister. Great man. You know Jim?
Jim, his son's... He's got
10 kids.
10 kids, is that right?
Yes, and his youngest one, Jackson, is at Walker Valley now. And Jim, I just feel like God wanted me to do something. I said, I know the Lord. I've been baptized. I did everything I thought I needed to do.
Yeah.
He said, you ever felt like you were called to ministry? I said, well, I'm not smart enough. You know, I was never a great student. And he said, just think about it. Pray about it. And so I prayed about it. God wouldn't let it go from my heart. And so I told him I felt called to ministry. And I went to Carson Newman and played football and baseball. I went to Carson Newman, played football, had three knee operations. Then I was a student assistant with the head football coach. You remember Ken Sparks at Carson Newman? He's the fifth. He passed Bear Bryant before he passed away as the fifth winningest coach of all time in college football. And then after all my knee operations, we got a new baseball coach who was also the wide receiver coach. And he came up to me and said, Lovingood, you pitched baseball against me in high school when I coached at Chattanooga Central. Why aren't you pitching baseball? I said, Coach, I've not picked a baseball up in 2 years. I can't pitch a baseball. He said, come out. Lord, I threw the ball slower and slowest. If I got faster and slower, I was coming out of the game. I picked the ball in two, 3 years. So went out there, made the team, was a relief pitcher for the last 2 years in college. Mm-hmm. So.
I bet that was a lot of fun.
It was fun. Because no pressure.
Baseball's a little different, isn't it?
I love it. I love it because here I sit out there in the outfield, relief pitcher, chewing on some sunflower seeds.
Yeah.
In a bucket.
Yeah. Yeah.
Juggling the ball, laughing, talking, and go in. And if you don't like pressure, there's no sense in playing baseball because, especially as a relief pitcher, you usually put in difficult situations.
Yeah.
And so...
Why do they bring the relief pitcher in at the end? Is what's the idea that why is a relief pitcher and the regular pitcher is not? Is it because I never have figured out the psychology of that?
Well, it's
almost like just the other pitcher.
Right, it is. But sometimes a starter, I think, has a little more longevity feel in a game than a relief pitcher. Sometimes if you saw my pitching for a long period of time, you could get used. Because I'm not Tim Dodd type of person, so I'm not going to mow you down. You know, Tim Dodd could throw, he could throw the heater all the time, or Teddy Carson heater all the time.
Or maybe only for three or four innings.
Yeah, and I'm going to throw a cut, a curve or a cutter, a changeup and stuff, to try to get you off balance after you've watched the big fastball for four or five innings. Then I come in slower, throwing junk, and you're way off your front foot. You know, that's the truth. And so,
those things, psychology helps us so much in life today, doesn't it?
It really, you're so right there.
I mean, think about that. It's so close to the reality.
And what happens? We're so, a lot of times in our world today, we're so self-focused. It helps us all realize that you take what you do real seriously, but don't take yourself so seriously. You know, it's okay. What happens is these guys, in a lot of times, in sports and life, they get so self-focused, all about me. And I'm like, man, come on now. There's people around us. Let's love on folks. Let's encourage people. And I think when you play on a team, it teaches you how to work with other people, encourage other folks.
And there's another inning. That inning's over.
Yeah, absolutely.
Think about that. That inning's over. We're at the end of the count or something,
right?
Coming up.
Yeah.
We got something to look forward to here, man. It's the new inning.
Well, I was telling my wife on the way, we were listening to Tennessee play against Notre Dame on the way over here from Memphis. And I said, they got 27 outs. She said, why do you say that for? I said, 9 times 3 is 27. They got to get you 27 outs. At the end of the day, you cut it any way you want to cut it.
Yeah.
There's 27 outs. And so, if you've not got the 27 outs, I still have a chance.
That's right. Did you ever remember when the other team was winning, they were way far ahead, and all of a sudden the losing team dugout starts to rally?
Right.
And you couldn't beat that team when they started to rally.
I think there's a psychology there. You know, it's like, oh my goodness, here they come.
It just, something about it is, it works.
Absolutely. They can put their rally caps on.
Oh, yeah.
Absolutely. And everybody's kind of got their quirky thing.
But it doesn't matter now if everybody's going to get a trophy.
You know, the sad thing about that is, what do they have to look forward to. There's no incentive. There's no, what's the goal? If everybody's going to get it,
what's the point?
What's the goal?
I don't understand.
To make us all feel better?
I mean, it's like the bank saying, we're going to give everybody a $50,000 loan.
Yes.
Well, why worry about paying for it?
Exactly.
So I don't understand the thinking. I understand giving some team spirits or cleanest player or something, mm-hmm. make something up, but don't just give participation.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Well, I think, unfortunately, is we don't want anybody to feel bad. But what happens in life is how many times I felt bad because I didn't win or I wasn't successful. Was that an incentive for me to go back to work, to get better?
Absolutely.
To improve, we're talking about my son Riley. All right, he came to me, he's in high school, in middle school. He was 5'4" in eighth grade. 5'4" in eighth grade. He came to me, Dean, he said, Dad, I want to play football in the SEC. I said, Riley, you're going to be a little short and a little slow. He said, I got a friend of mine, Adam Miles, who played deep snapper, Tennessee. I'm going to pay him $20 every Thursday to teach me how to snap. I said, I thought it was like guitar lessons. You ever heard a kid, I'm going to be the best guitar. I'm going to pick up a guitar.
Sure.
And I said, well, go do it.
Yeah.
Go do it. It was his $20. He put it in. He got skin in the game. Paid Adam Miles. So he put a tape on the basketball goal in a field goal snap and a punt snap. And I'd hear him out all hours of the night. I'm like, he put flashlights in a tree. Out there by himself. There's no crowd, nobody. And so I wouldn't catch him for the first year. I didn't catch him a snap. And my wife would go out there in oven mitts. Rachel would go out there in oven mitts and catch him. I said, he's not serious. You remember a guy named Ray Guy, who was the first punter in the history of the NFL to be named to the Hall of Fame of the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Mm-hmm. Played with the Oakland Raiders. Mm-hmm. I took Riley Lovingood to the first camp, Ray Guy in Nashville. And I said, Mr. Guy, how good of a snapper is Riley? He's in the ninth grade. How good of a snapper is Riley? I said, I've already paid for your camp, so tell me the truth. Just tell me the truth. I ain't going to ask for my money. He said, Mr. Lovingood, all due respect, I'm going to rank him at top five in the country today. Well, he started growing, D. And all of a sudden, the high school coach asked him to play in the varsity as a freshman in the varsity in the state championship game. As a freshman, got the snap in the state championship game at Beach High School in Hendersonville, Tennessee. Well, when he was a sophomore going to be a junior in high school, we went to the Nationals snapping contest in Las Vegas. It had special teams, punters, kickers, and snappers. And by that time, he had grown from 5'4" to 6 foot.
Golly.
And all of a sudden, everybody's looking at him, what the heck? And all of a sudden, he snaps the ball faster than anybody there. Now, everybody's looking around, where's this kid come from? And so they ranked him in the top three in the country in Rivals or 247 Sports. And then Tennessee started looking at him, Auburn started looking at him, different major schools across the country. And then he grew to 6'1", 6'2".
God.
Well, what happened is this, when he was 5'4", if everybody gave him a trophy then, it was the winner. But he went out there with no applause. There's no crowd. Mm. I'm self-motivated. This is what I want to do. When he was a senior in high, he committed to the University of Tennessee to play football. When he was a senior in high school, ESPN ranked him the number one deep snapper in the country that year. When he was an eighth grader, I told him he was going to be a little slow and too small.
Well, you was wrong.
Bad. But you know what? If I said, yeah, I'm going to give you a trophy today, you could do it.
He'd have just gone on to something else.
But I said, I don't know. But but it was his dream. It was his dream. He owned it. And then he worked when nobody else was looking. And that, I think, what we want to challenge kids or people with, hey, you know, what's your dream? Go for it. You don't always have to get a trophy at the beginning. And at the end of the day, you might not be totally successful with your whatever.
At least you know
but
it.
But you went for it.
And you know it.
Absolutely. You went
I'm
for
no
it.
Good at that. I'm going to do something else.
That's right. Absolutely. But we don't. There's a little motto that I've tried to live by. Be more fearful of missing opportunity than fearful of failing.
Boy, that is
the
truth.
Be more fearful of missing opportunity than fearful of failing.
I've never regretted what I've done more than I regretted what I didn't do.
Let me tell you about Capstar Bank. They're located in Nashville, Hendersonville, Gallatin, Athens, Madisonville, Sweetwater, Etowah, and in Cleveland at 950 25th Street and 3855 North Okoye Street. I've used them. I like them. Give them a try. They're no problem.
I was in seventh grade, D. I couldn't read.
At Cleveland or Bradley?
Bradley. Well, really, North Lee.
Well, that was a good school.
Miss Ashley. Nancy Ashley. First time, seventh grade. Second time in seventh grade at Okoye Middle School now. It's Bradley Junior High at the time.
Going to North Lee was an odd. That was a stretch for y'all, right? Going all the way to North
Absolutely.
Lee.
Absolutely. You're looking. Oh gosh. Sorry. North Lee's way out in the country.
Yeah.
It's past Fulbright Park.
Did y'all bus there, or did you have to get had a?
My daddy took me with his old pickup truck.
He knew, didn't he?
Yeah. He took me in the old pickup truck out there. Coach Montgomery and Coach Curtis coached out
Coach
there.
Coach Curtis, I remember.
Kerr hit.
Did you ever have to sweep the gym?
They went down there. Mr. Ingham was the principal.
Yeah, Mr. Ingham. He paddled me.
He could play ping pong with the best of them.
Boy, I didn't like him.
He's tough, boy. I was the first time sure.
I wasn't even guilty, and he paddled me.
Hey, you probably needed it.
I was not guilty, and he paddled me.
That make you feel bad?
I'm mad about it today.
I can tell, but it didn't stunt you anyway.
It didn't hurt me.
You
it was after school, after hours. School wasn't even in session.
But he's strong. I bet he could paddle pretty strong.
Oh, he paddled the shit out of me.
You know who could paddle the worst though? Jim Smitty.
Jim Smitty.
I'll tell you right now, that rascal could paddle.
He carried it in his back pocket, I believe, didn't he?
Yes.
Didn't he carry it?
Coach Smitty, I used to go out there.
You know, that was a deterrent, wasn't it?
He
walked around school with it in his back pocket.
Yes, sir. And I'm going to tell you right now, I used to shag golf balls for him in PE class. He'd be hitting golf balls. I'd go out there and get them golf balls and bring it back to him. He was a unique man.
Is he still alive?
No, sir. But I'll tell you something. You talk about a basketball coach. What about the Bears?
He was Bears. One of the best.
Of all time.
I don't know
how many games they ever lost in the 1970s.
It's so phenomenal. We don't even recall what it was. It was so good.
He would practice those girls, I believe, on Thanksgiving and Christmas Day. He'd get over there and they'd come to practice.
They'd be sweating and he'd be sweating.
Oh, he'd challenge those girls. Liz Handy used to tell me this story all the time. And Liz Jackson, some people would remember her, Turner's wife. And she could shoot that basketball. My dad and mom would go to the girls' basketball games and leave at Bradley because they were so good. I said, Dad, that's what the boys play.
Yep.
Well, the girls were so good. They, you know, everybody wanted to follow them. I think the boys were good, too, at the time. But Liz Hannah, Dana Caldwell, Montgomery.
And Keith Mills' sister.
Oh, Karen Mills.
Karen Mills.
Little
blonde-headed
girl. Yeah. At their state championship in, I think, 76 or somewhere in there, she shot.
Winning shot.
Yeah, at the end.
You know, she's a comedian now.
I've seen that. I've not seen her whole show, but I've seen it.
I went to a thing here about a month ago,
And she's really good.
Well, I guarantee you.
I mean, you can tell she's good at whatever she's going to do.
Well, now I think Cleveland, Tennessee's got a lot of good people like that.
We have got.
I'll tell you something. Here's what David Lanham and I used to tell people all over the country. Cleveland, Tennessee is the hub of the universe. Mm-hmm. I love this town. I'm telling you, I love it so much. This year, Dee, my wife, Rachel, had 3 surgeries. I had my mother-in-law, Jane Tollett, Charles Tollett. You remember Charles mm-hmm. Tollett? That's my mother-in-law. She had 4 brain procedures. I had a massive heart attack, open heart surgery. Then my mama dies 2 months later. And I'm telling you something, this community, buddy, I can't tell you how much this community's blessed me.
Hey, there for a while, you couldn't get on Facebook if they weren't talking about Jeff Lovingood.
It was I'm talking about, you talking about blessing me.
You didn't know you was that popular.
It's scary. But I tell you something, people, this community, I get notes and cards, words of encouragement, and just the kindest people praying for you, encouraging you, supporting you. It was just, I often wonder why God was bringing me back to Cleveland. And I think obviously the Lord knew I was getting ready to go maybe through some times, tough times. But what God has done through the people of Cleveland has meant so much to me, way more than I could ever do anything for the city and the county of Bradley County. It's unbelievable.
I wonder where that started. Was it a small knit community that was God-fearing, and that's what promulgated all of this? Or it makes you wonder why, because I don't really see Athens that way. I don't see Decatur is that way, but Cleveland is just that way.
I think you have people that have a go for it mentality. They want to go. Whatever they do, let's go for it. Let's try to be the best we can be in academics, athletics, business, whatever. Let's go for it. And they love a winner. But the fact of it is, they're not always for the super dog. A lot of times they're for the underdog. And and they care about you. They're not arrogance, puffing yourself up is not necessarily a trait that I think bodes well in Cleveland, Tennessee.
It doesn't go well.
No, sir. And I tell you what I think goes well is making much of others, caring about people. And I'll tell you what, like I said a while ago, you can't outgive the people of Cleveland. I'll tell you what. When my dad died, when I was a senior in high school, my dad died. We didn't have a lot of money, buddy.
I don't know how you made it without a father.
We didn't have a lot of money at all. Eddie Cartwright, Johnny Holden, been like that. Eddie Cartwright gave my mother a job at the courthouse. We didn't know what he was going to do. Eddie Cartwright gave my mother a job working with him. Johnny Holden helped me a ton figuring things out. People in the church. Benny Kirksey, Pat Inslee. Those top people. But, I mean, those families. I mean, you're talking about Eddie Cartwright, Johnny Holden, Pat Inslee, the Kirksey family. Those are some of the salt of the earth people.
And they had no reason to do that. What was the reason?
Because they care. That was the reason. It wasn't going to help them.
Not a bit.
It was a caring for others. For me and I was 17, 18 years old. My brother was 15 years old, 15, 16.
I remember the morning of. I'm telling you, it was that significant to me.
And
because I had seen him at the ballpark so much.
I was walking at Bradley. I got here. I've been here 3 or 4 years. I was walking at Bradley High School one day, and Mr. Frazier, Jerry Frazier,
Jerry
was in his golf cart there at the end of the football field. And I walked in. He said, "Jeff, come here and talk to me. I'm going to talk to you guys." Well, my grandmother, my dad's mama, was 4'8", had 12 kids, outlived them all but two. She was 4'8", lived in there by Bishop's Bakery, right across the street. Well, Frazier's grandmother lived right across the street from my grandmother. And so I knew Roger, Jerry, and Mike. We grew up together, throwing rocks. We played a game called throwing rocks at each other.
When you went and stayed at your grandmother.
Yeah, like Ernest T. Bass, you know.
Ernest T.
Yeah, and I could smell, you remember, you smelled that. One thing about going to my grandmother's, I could smell that Bishop's Bakery. Oh,
especially when you was taking swimming lessons at the community. Absolutely. Center. Did you ever take swimming lessons?
I played baseball there. Ralph Reimer taught me how to hit a baseball over at some. I had a little blue bat to hit a baseball over at that fence.
Did you ever ride those things that you, those springs?
Yeah.
What was those?
Like the little duck things?
Yeah, they were.
With those big old thick springs.
Yeah, I don't know what the point was. Did you ever ride those?
Yeah, all the time I get on one. So, you know, Brenda Lawson. She'd come down there and she was married to Toby.
Toby, yeah.
McKenzie.
Toby. Got to go way back to call him Toby.
Yeah. And so, driving a Pinto, throwing the papers
right. Barefooted.
Yes, absolutely. And so, she would come down to my grandmother's.
Volkswagen.
That's right. And we'd have cornbread and milk.
Put it in with salt, with a little pepper on top.
Oh, my grandmother liked buttermilk, but I couldn't stand buttermilk.
I couldn't either.
I liked the sweet milk.
Just the milk.
And so we'd eat there and sit on the front porch and swing and talk to Brenda, my grandmother, Nanny. We called her Nanny. But most people called her Pearl. And right across the street were the Frasers. So we had Frasers. We grew up together.
Yeah.
So I'm walking in the football field there at Bradley. He said, Jeff, I need your help with something. I said, what do you need? He said, we need to help with the Education Foundation. We're going to get some young guys, and we're kind of getting a little long in the tooth. Would you help us? I said, Mr. Frazier, I'll help you do whatever you want to do. Just let me get to the first year. And after the first year, just tell me what y'all want. And so he died of COVID.
I remember that. Yeah.
And it just tore me up. Mm. And because we had been friends forever. And the mayor and a couple of guys called me and said, hey, Ms. Frazier really wants you to finish his term on the school board. I do.
That's not your thing, is it?
No, I didn't really necessarily want to be. I don't have any kids. My kids are all gone. I didn't want to. But I felt.
Well, you'd be good at it.
A responsibility.
Yeah.
To Jerry to finish his term out. So I finished his term out on the school board. Here I am sitting on a school board. I didn't have a fat clue. I didn't know what was going on. I just, you know, I love kids, love the community. And what you're saying before, what we were taught, you and I were taught, we all were taught by people that have gone before us, it's not about always you. It's about caring for others and helping other people. That was, going back to what you said a while ago, where did this all start? I think the generations before us taught us what was important in life. And I think it's our responsibility to teach the next generation what's valuable, what's valued in Cleveland, Tennessee.
And that you can't, and that you have to strive to do better. You have to try to win. Sometimes you don't win. And look out, you may not win. Right. That's important to know. You may not win.
Yes, sir. You and I both have people that are in the political world in our town that ran for office this time. Mm-hmm. Good friends. Mm-hmm. My job in the ministry, I'm for everybody.
You're for who's? You've got to be for everybody. And you probably are for everybody.
Yes. I don't put I love people. So if I pick you over this one, then I hurt ministry. I'm for everybody. I want everybody. Well, there's some political there's some things I deeply believe in that I'm going to vote for. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. But I'm not going to choose you over him publicly. I just can't. It's hard for me to do that.
You gotta be careful.
Yeah. But I talked to these guys after the election. They said, Jeff, can you have lunch or me have lunch? Well, sure. I go, well, talk to me. They talk about the elections or different things. I said, listen to me. I said, running for politics is what you do. It's not who you are. If you run for the political world, if you play football, my son, Trent Riley, playing football at Tennessee, if it's who you are, when you put your cleats up, what's going to happen with you? Now, what's my purpose in life? If I run for election and that's who I am, oh my goodness. If it's over, is my life through? No.
I see what you're saying. That's extremely, say that again. That's extremely brilliant. I've never heard anybody put it that way.
Well, it's what you do. It's not who you are. So if you are.
Say you're, yeah, you're exactly right. Say you're driving down the road and you run a stop sign and the police stop you and give you a ticket. You're not a bad driver. That's what you're saying, right? It's just not, you're not a.
Well, you, for example, Peyton Manning. He played football a long time.
He was on Saturday Night Live last night.
New Orleans High School, Catholic High School, New Orleans. University of Tennessee. Baltimore Colts. Denver Broncos. But there was a time he had to retire. Now, what happens to me if I felt like playing football was all about who I was, what I did? Now, after I hung them up, now what do I do? Now, I can use football as a platform to do other things, but my football career as a football player is over with. It can't determine who you are as a person. And so many times, if we lose at something, if we finish with something, and it determines who we are, then we go into a fetal position and quit. Say you're running for, governor of Tennessee. All right? You're running against Lee, and you lose. That was something you were going to do. It can't determine who you are. Because you're not finished. You're not finished as a person.
We gotta let our actions determine who we are and not the events. Is that a good way to put it?
That's a great way. And you know, kids today, if we put so much value on what we do, and it doesn't go the way we think it should. How many kids did say, I quit? I give up.
We used to call them sore losers. Remember that? That was a thing.
Because they found their identity in that.
And that's why a lot of people retire at 65 and they die. But that was their identity.
Bear Bryant. Bear Bryant died quickly. After he quit coaching football at Alabama.
Because he was a coach. That was his thing.
That was who he was. Good at it. He was real good at it.
He was even in Forrest Gump.
Run, Forrest, run, run, run. You know, I think that in our community, in Cleveland, that's why Dave and I used to call it the hub of the universe. There's so many good people that want to do well, that care for others, that have a non-quit mindset. I think that's why we're good at wrestling. You ever wonder why in the world is Cleveland, Tennessee so good at wrestling in high school?
Yeah, it's not like, usually that goes to places that are colder weather where sports are more inside.
Yes.
I mean, we can ski, water ski, or play baseball, but yet we're good at an indoor sport.
And there's some discipline, determination in wrestling that I think that's not like it a lot of the other sports.
There's something about being on your back and that guy's about to pin you and you don't have any more breath. We've all been there.
Tanner Jackson says he's got a video, a 30-second video DVD, how to get off your back in 30 seconds. He just playing around. But
yeah.
I think wrestling is a spirit of Cleveland, Tennessee. The can-do-it mindset, the work hard, the work ethic, the I care about my team members even though I'm going to fight for it individually.
And it matters or something. Something about it matters. It matters is important.
Exactly right.
You have to find a reason to tell your mind that it matters.
You know, that could be a billboard here.
What was it I said? It matters. It matters, yeah.
Cleveland, Tennessee.
It matters.
It matters.
Find the reason it matters. It's not enough to just say it matters. You got to find the reason it matters.
You know, that's interesting you say that. I say that a lot. Why does it matter?
If you know the why, it's hard not to do it.
I say this. If I know the why, I can put up with almost any how.
That's right. Boy, that's good too.
But the problem is a lot of people want to focus on the how, but the why is the engine behind it.
You got to have the why.
Exactly. Look here. We're going to make a billboard right here. Cleveland, Tennessee, it matters.
It matters.
And quote, why?
Genius.
That's all of it. No, you thought of it. You know, we both thought of it. But I think that
and that came from Corky Whitlock doing the Pledge of Allegiance and Corky. Everybody.
I never forget so many times.
I wished I could have him on this show so bad.
Interview.
Do you know how bad I wished I could have him?
I'll tell you something. Corky, he called me Toad. Toad. Louie named me that at a Bradley
Alford?
Yes. Louie Alford named me that at a Bradley Cleveland basketball game. I wasn't a great basketball player, but I shot a ball one time and I made it. And like a frog called me. So he started calling me Toad. And you know, when I would be interviewed by Corky, he would talk so fast. You know, he's talking so fast. I'm like, my mind's not even operating fast, Corky. And he would call me Toad.
And he was such an older man at the time in our mind.
Absolutely. And you know, my dad and Corky, such good friends. I love when I have guests come to my house and we visit or talk, and speakers that come to church or whatever. I think it's pride. Is I take them up the new ballpark up the Brad. I know it's not new to everybody right here now, but in my mind, it's
not the same.
It's not, because Fulbright Park's in the heart of the city. I mean, it was the heartbeat of this whole place. Go over there and get me a Baskin Robbins ice cream or whatever.
You had to walk.
Absolutely. Go to Shoney's with Cletus Benton. My mother loved that spaghetti. And then for dessert, get that
strawberry shortcake.
Or the
strawberry shortcake.
Or the fudge with that.
What was it they called that? They had a name for that.
That hot fudge with that ice cream in the middle of it.
Yeah, but they had a name for it.
I guess
it was hot fudge cake.
Yeah. Well, what I do is I go now when people come in, I take them up to the ballpark and have Whitlock Field, Whitlock Complex, and then my dad, Lovingood Field.
Yeah.
And I just tell them the stories, you know, reflect on what was.
I can smell the concession stand. Can't you?
Popcorn. And those hot dogs, slaw.
Slaw.
Remember the Watson's hot slaw? Oh, I love Watson's hot slaw. I get that hot dog with hot slaw on it. Oh, goodness gracious.
Give me a hamburger.
That's not good for
me.
He's had a heart attack.
Remember when they used to buy the Cokes for people at the end of the game?
Yes,
Everybody'd run towards that.
Yeah, you got to get your free Coke. Run out there.
I bet those Cokes were that big, but they seemed so big, didn't they?
Yes,
were you on Bebo's team?
No, Bebo. I love Bebo.
Because he was friends with Louis.
Oh, yes. But Bebo... See, when I played at Bradley, Bebo played defensive end. It was I played offensive line, and Bebo's over there. And then Bebo and I went to church together. And we loved to go to live wrestling down in Chattanooga, Memorial Auditorium.
You mean, did y'all go to Candy's Creek, or where'd you go?
First Baptist.
First Baptist. Oh, there's one up here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
It was downtown.
That's right. That's right.
And Jim Gibson was our youth minister. Yeah. Marvin Gibson was the
Marvin
pastor.
Gibson.
Down, and Gene
I remember
Gibson.
Marvin.
Oh, man, you talking about flashy. Drove a Corvette. People don't know when Marvin came to First Baptist Cleveland, he was 27 years old.
Well, I didn't know him until he was in his 80s. Worked for the telephone company, right?
No, it's Marvin Gibson who was his.
I'm thinking Marvin Gill.
Yeah, this is Marvin.
You're thinking Marvin Gibson, the
pastor at First Baptist Church when I was,
Different Marvin.
And so Bebo and myself and Landreth used to go down to Memorial. Did you ever go to Memorial Auditorium? Watch Tojo Yamamoto and all those people wrestle, live wrestling down there at Memorial Auditorium. There's some Samoans coming
what
in.
What was the name of that place?
There's nobody. I'm having a conversation with somebody. I haven't had this type of conversation with you.
What was the name of that thing? Memorial Auditorium.
Yeah.
Tojo Yamamoto.
Yes. I bet he went 5'7".
Boy, that was a long ways. That was a long drive in my mind then. And we were going to another country.
It's like when your parents let you go to Chattanooga the first time. You're like,
man, that's a whole other world.
What in the world are we doing? And then go down there and there's lights on that Memorial Auditorium. We thought we was going to New York City. We go down there and that wrestling, they come in there. I thought Bebo was going to go in the wrestling ring one day. I said, Bebo, you can't go up there. That kid.
He would.
He's the funniest. We had so much fun together.
He is a great guy.
Bebo, I talked to him a week and a half ago. He'll call and check on me. He'd give his shirt off your back.
He'll say, hey, what are you doing?
Yeah.
He'll start whispering like he's telling you a secret, and really it's not a secret.
At Zane, see, we used to go over his house.
Zane B.
We'd have Sunday afternoon lunch, this fellowship over there. Anna, Bebo, Missy.
Missy married Toad, right? I'm missing that up. Yeah, I'm missing that up.
That was why I was gone.
I better stop there, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Some of this stuff, get it. I bet you got a good editor back there. But I tell you, Bebo.
Bebo, I love Bebo. Is his real name Bebo?
It is, I think. Zane B. Harris.
Zane B. Harris. But what about the B? Didn't you think it's Bebo?
I have no idea. Zane B. Harris. I believe that's his name. I don't know if Bebo is Zane Bebo Harris. I know it's Zane B. Harris. I guess it's Bebo.
I don't know.
I don't have a clue. But he is big as house. But he wasn't that big in high school. He would hit you. He wasn't the quickest guy in the world. But he would hit you. You got to sense that on one side, you had Bebo as a defensive end. And on the other side, you had Dale Jones. My Swanee, you're talking about a baller.
It wouldn't matter who you got hit by. It'd be about the same, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but I believe I'd rather run at Bebo than Dale because Dale could catch you. Bebo was, if you ran right at Bebo, he's going to kill you. But you could maybe outrun him a little bit.
He was real strong, wasn't he?
As a young mule, stronger and strong. But you know, the honest thing about this, when you go fighting your back for a long time, they gave me a 30% chance to live.
Yes, tell me about that. First, I'll tell you where I was at. I was driving to church on 64 Highway. Mm-hmm. It was a morning.
Good Church of Christ.
Church of Christ.
I remember.
That's right. I was going to Union Grove.
What about the man who remembers your Church of Christ?
When we were driving, and there was on 64 Highway, and there was a pond, and my dad said, Mr. Lovingood died.
Yeah.
And I remembered that because you had the tractors.
Yes, sir.
Around the pond. Because he worked for the John Deere, right?
Ford. He worked at Dooley Tractor Company in Athens, then he worked at South Bradley County, down there past Waterville. Remember the old Ford.
But he was, wasn't he displaying them there on 64 Highway where the pond is?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Was that y'all's property then?
No, it was, whose property was that? He was kind of, as people were going out 64, he let people see what was going on. Okay,
because that's what brought
By the old fair, didn't it have,
Before you get to the...
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. We used to have something out there. My dad would go out there all the time. I forget. It's been a minute. What happened was this. He had won a trip with Ford to go to the Indianapolis 500 because of sales. And he asked me if I'd go with him. And I had something to do with Carson Newman at the time because I had signed a football scholarship. I said, Dad, you're tired. I said, go up there and have fun and relax with your buddies. And Coach Sparks wants me to do something at Carson Newman that week. So we went up there to the race. And I was at church. And on Sunday afternoon, they came and knocked at the choir room door. I was in church. And actually, I was sitting by Bebo and David Lambeth in church. And they came and got me out of church and told me he had died of a heart attack.
Was you evening church or Sunday morning church?
It was evening church. It was really before church. It was youth choir. You remember the day you used to have youth choir?
Yeah. It was the church before the Sunday night church.
Yeah. I used to go because I couldn't sing a lick. But I liked snack supper because that all had
good. Bebo loves to sing.
Oh, he loved.
Sometimes he'll call me singing. He'll just be singing.
Hey, there's some people in this town that if it all goes haywire, Brenda Lawson's one of those people. Bebo's one of those. Mm-hmm. Eddie Cartwright's one of those people. There's a lit. Pat Inslee, Benny Curtin. There's a litany of people that I know if I was in a ditch, it didn't matter where I was.
And if you had to call them for gas, you wouldn't worry about them getting irritated.
No.
You know, you got friends like that. They'd come and get me, but they'd get irritated.
No, they'd laugh at me.
Yeah, they'd say, hey, I'm on my way.
Yeah, I'll be right there. And they'd give me a hard time because they'd just poke at me a little bit. But my dad died, and then my mom had a lot of tough times there. And that's when Eddie Cartwright took my mama and gave her a job at their courthouse. Here's the interesting thing is, Dee. My father-in-law, Charles Tollett, was running right after that. My mom was the head of the Women's Republican Society right after that. And Charles Tollett was running for state senate as a Democrat. My mom was the head of the Women's Republican Society. So I used to go trying to woo my now wife to Charles's rallies where all these big Democrats were.
Was you in high school then or what?
I was into my senior year. No, it was my senior year in college. Junior and senior in college. So that was 3 years after that. So my mom kind of recovered a little bit after my dad has passed away.
Now, did you have the same heart? Did your dad die sudden?
Massive heart attack, yes.
Just didn't know what hit him.
And the same thing happened to me. I was walking.
How old were you then? Probably 53, 54?
What? No, I just 56. Had it.
56.
How?
No, it's been about 2 years ago.
It's been a year and 2 months. It was last April. It was Easter.
So it happened all at once?
All at once. I'm walking. I walked about 100 yards and I had a pain from here across my chest, up my neck. It was like getting branded.
It wasn't just that feels
no, 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 no. It was like a branding. And Rachel got me down to Memorial Hospital. And they said, sir, you're having a massive heart attack.
Did she drive you that way?
Yeah, drove me down there.
Was you scared?
I didn't know what was going on. I couldn't get away. I couldn't get away from it.
You thought maybe it's pulled like muscle or
gas or something. Whatever. Yeah. And I got down there and they did EKG and said, you're having a massive heart attack. They said, well, we can put some stents in, you're going to be all right. So they went and they put two stents in.
That right then?
Mm-hmm. And they put two stents in. And then when they did that, they found three main arteries were blocked. And I call it my night alone with the Lord. Because that night was COVID, so Rachel couldn't come back there.
God.
And it was just me. My heart was in AFib. And they gave me a 30% chance of making it through open heart surgery.
So you get there, they take you back, and they do EKGs, and you're sitting there thinking, was it the onions I ate or whatever? Mm-hmm. And they said, man, we checked you out, and you're having a heart attack.
It's And there was, they did EKG, and a guy walked in and said, "You're having a heart attack right now. We got to go." And they put me back. They got IVs in me. They took me back there and did a they did the stents. They did a stent. They found all the blockages. And they told my wife, "Hey, he's going to have open heart surgery tomorrow."
Golly, so it wasn't over.
No. And my heart was an AFib.
What does that mean?
It's when you irregular heart rate.
So did jumping you, all did around. You feel it?
Oh, my goodness. You could feel it like crazy. And the monitors were going off. And so it was just me and the nurse, a couple nurses. My wife couldn't come back because of COVID. And so, man, I got to singing in there. Got to singing. And I'm a terrible singer. I'm not like Bebo. And the next day, they prepped me for surgery.
But describe that night more. How you feel? What are you thinking? What's going through your mind?
That's a great... I sang a song that night, "I Need Thee Every Hour." You ever heard that song? It's an old song. I need thee every hour. And so I just kept singing, and I started praying, and I started quoting scripture. And I just,
it's a Lord's Supper song.
Yes.
Usually.
Yes, sir. And I was just sitting there, and all of a sudden, I just had a peace. Even though my heart was an AFib, it was kind of, I call it my night alone with the Lord. It was just me and the Lord, and my heart's in AFib.
But from the time you got in the car,
right,
and you're going to head, you think, well, I better go to Memorial. Mm-hmm. How long is it from there till they say, you got to have open heart surgery tomorrow? What we just did didn't work.
They were great at
Was it like
you
5 hours?
No. I got there. I walk in. I said, "Ma'am, I'm having chest pains." She said, "Sit right there." And my wife parked the car, came back in, and she said, "We're taking you back now." I mean, 2-3 minutes. I'm back there, EKG. They do the triage, you know, the heart, your blood pressure, your heart rate, and your temperature. He comes in and said, "You're having a massive heart attack. Let's go." He gets in there. They put IVs on me. They strip my stuff off. They put a nightgown on me. He tells Rachel, said, "Here's what's going on." I'm talking about 45 minutes. I'm going back.
So it was an hour and 15 minutes.
Yes.
Something like that.
Yes. The whole thing from the time I'm walking, get to Chattanooga.
And you're just thinking about what you're going to eat.
Yes.
Next thing you know, they're wheeling you back. God. Hello, I'm Dee Burris, and most of you know me as a general contractor. In October of 2020, I started a podcast that I call The Discussion with Dee Burris. Each week, I have conversations with interesting, informative, and fascinating people from Cleveland and Bradley County and the surrounding areas. You can watch The Discussion at DeeBurris.com on YouTube and Facebook, where we would ask you to please subscribe, it's free, for updates and notifications of new shows. It's no problem. All right, now after you're there, it's been an hour and 15 minutes, they're wheeling you back. What's next?
Well, I think I'm just getting stents. And Rachel thinks, Rachel says, we're just getting a couple stents. Well, when they got in there, they found the main three arteries were all blocked. You know, the Widowmaker, so they have, that's the top. And then they break down to three main arteries, then it branches out. Well, all three of my main arteries are blocked.
And how many main arteries are there?
I think there's three main ones. They got one, and it bumps into three, which jumps it.
So you were just barely making it.
And all of a sudden, they get in there, and Rachel goes out and tells my kids that he's going to be all right. They're going to do a couple stents. He'll be all right. When they get in there, they found out I have major blockage. So they come back, and Rachel wasn't in there. And they tell me, said, Jeff, I hate to tell you this, that you're going to have open heart surgery. All three of your arteries, major arteries, are all blocked. And my wife, they called Rachel, said, did you tell him that without me being in there? Because there's two things, Dee, that's kind of haunted me all my life because of my dad. One was having a heart attack. Two was having open heart surgery. And here I was having a heart attack. And then they tell me, you're going to have major open heart surgery. Mm-hmm. It's going to be between 3 and 7 bypasses. Well, I think 7's the means you never have. And so that night is when I caught my night alone with the Lord. They tell Rachel what's going on. She can't come back in there with me. It's just me. I'm talking to her on the phone because of COVID. They're afraid of COVID being passed around. So I wheel me up to ICU, and it's me and these little nurses, and my heart's in AFib, and that's when I started singing and quoting scripture. And
were you coherent or just scared?
Totally coherent. And didn't sleep all night. And I just... You know that verse of scripture, surely goodness and
mercy shall follow me.
I had a sense of the Holy Spirit in my life so strong, and goodness and mercy surrounded me all the days of my life. I'm sitting there and I was at peace. And I just quoted scripture and singing. And the next day, Rachel came up. They prepped me for surgery. And here's the thing, I don't know why they do this. They give you a mortality rate.
Golly, how morbid can they be?
They walked in, I guess they do have to do it for insurance sake, to tell you what's going to happen to you as you're going to surgery.
I guess so you can make a decision.
I guess. There was nothing else I was going to do. What was I going to do?
What was I going to do?
Say, well, no, I'm not going to have surgery. You know what I'm saying? And so... I wouldn't. And so they came in there and gave me a 30% chance of making it through surgery. I'm sitting there with my wife. I said,
what were the words?
A 30. I looked at, here's exactly what I said. 30 from 0 or 30 from 100? Because if I have a 0 chance, 30 is pretty good. But if it's 30 from 100, boy, the last time I remember, that's an F. You know? And so I looked at Rachel, I said, I got a 30% chance to live. And I said, can we just pray right now? The doctor's sitting right there. Rachel said, let's just pray. So we started praying. I started squalling. We started praying. And they started rolling me down to the operating room. Rachel's walking with me. And Dee, when I let my wife's hand go, I just looked at her. I said, honey, I'll see you. When I get out of surgery, I'll see you in a minute in heaven. And I just squalled.
One or the other.
I mean, and when I got in that surgery operating room, all the nurses and doctors sitting there, they're getting ready for surgery. They're getting ready to knock me out. I said, whoa. I said, you care if I pray with us right now? And they said, no, you pray.
Were they receptive and?
Totally. Unbelievable. And I just prayed. I said, I'll never forget my prayer. I said, Lord, would you just guide these doctors and nurses' hands? Thank you that you've blessed them to do this surgery. I pray that they'll honor you as they operate on my body, and it'll be glory to you. And when I shut my eyes, I was thinking, what I'm gonna see in heaven.
With faith, we have to be okay with either one, don't we?
I guess. Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. At the end of the day, I'm thinking, surely good. I felt such a peace It's hard to describe it. I honestly, not that I've ever lied to you, is about the peace that I felt. You know how they say peace passes all understanding? I had such a peace.
Down in my heart.
Yeah. You know, I just had such a peace. And then when I got out of surgery, I got up in ICU. I can remember those nurses.
Was it like a minute you're back?
I don't even, you know.
I've been there. I had a colonoscopy checked. It was like, we're here and now we're done.
Colonoscopy is the best sleep you all ever had.
Boy, it's the best, isn't it? If they could put that stuff in a drug, we'd all be drug addicts.
I'm talking about, I've had a colonoscopy. I'm like, that's the best sleep I ever had in my life, man. But when I woke up after that bypass, and these nurses, they'd come in and they'd pray with me. It was interesting. The head of nurse at Memorial and the ICU was a church member at our church.
What are the odds? Now, that's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. It's too coincidental, those things.
No, what absolutely. What are the odds? Absolutely. And they would come in and they said, we know you're a preacher. We're going to pray with you right now. And they would pray with me. And it was just, and people ask me, I can't tell you this. This is the most interesting. Rachel and I talk about this a lot. I can't tell you how many men over the age of 40 ask me what a heart attack feels like. And then they ask me, what does it feel like going through open heart surgery? It's unbelievable. I get calls all the time of folks asking me what it was like to have, what did it feel like? Like you asked me, what did it feel like? And then asked me, what is it like going through open heart surgery? I never would wish open heart surgery on anyone. Because honestly, they just cracking your chest open it up, and put your heart on a platter over here. And they taking the artery vein out of your leg and doing bypass surgery over your blockage.
Using your own veins to...
Yes, sir. And the worst thing about that, I think the whole surgery, there's three worst things. There's three things that are just terrible. One is this, when they pull the tubes out of you. They have drainage tubes between your heart and lungs, inside your skin. And they say, I'll never forget this nurse. She said, Mr. Lovingood, you're doing so great. We're going to take the tubes out today. I said, well, okay, when are they going to give you? Well, you're not going to get anything. Take a big breath and count to three, and we're going to pull them out one at a time. D. I've never felt pain like that in my boy. I'm talking about terrible.
Was it like that, or was it a long excruciating?
No, they pulled it quick, but it was a gentleman. But the second thing is this, when you would sneeze or cough, they give you this pillow, a heart pillow, that you have to hug on to make it tight on your chest. That is your, I have that heart pillow in my office behind my desk right now that I look at every day. That's my buddy. That became my buddy. I'd hold a hug on that thing. And the third thing is this, is my wife, unbelievable. She walked with me through that. I mean, we'd go walking at Lee or walking around, and I'd walk so slow. She'd hold my hand, hold me up, take care of me.
Did you lose weight?
Like, I weigh now what I weighed in the ninth grade. I've lost so much weight.
You look like you're in such good shape. It's really incredible.
Well, I work at it right now. I worked at it before, but what happened was, I walk every day, treadmill, do a bike every day, and Rachel and I, in our marriage of 35 years in December, we've been married 35 years in December, we've walked about every night together and talked. And at Lee University, we park out there in the softball field, another little parking lot out there.
I love that parking lot.
And I walk to it around Okoye Street, and we just talk. It's our
fortress of solitude.
Golly, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Like Superman, he had the fortress of solitude.
Yes, sir. And my wife, and I love walking down Okoye Street. It's one of my favorite things. And just, you know.
Do you think it was diet or just genetics?
Yes,
or?
Genetics. Because my cholesterol was good. Blood pressure was good. Heart rate's good. But genetics is just...
Would they have found it if you'd gone 2 months earlier?
I don't know. Probably.
Well, do you think that if you was out doing exercises that you'd have noticed that you'd got...
Well, I was doing exercise every day. Before that. Do you understand something? The day I had a heart attack, that weekend, that heart attack, on Friday, we had a groundbreaking service at First Baptist Church, Good Friday. Then I worked out, rode a bike, treadmill, Rachel and I went for a walk. On Saturday, we had an Easter egg hunt, 2 services. Pat Inslee and I played pickleball for 2.5 hours.
Golly.
On Sunday, we baptized 100 people. I baptized, I think, 30 of those people.
That's a lot, isn't it?
I baptized about 30. Went up to Knoxville, played Easter egg hunt with grandkids, came back and played pickleball with our worship pastor's kids, and then Rachel and I went for a walk. I did all that weekend, didn't have a pain one. Didn't have one pain. But went for a walk, something I did every night for about 100 yards, and I got, there was a pain. That's what happened.
Could you have almost not even gone to the hospital?
Well, I could have. But I just knew something wasn't right. I just knew. I said, Rachel, we got to go. Something's not right.
Now, when you got out and you got your... What was you in the hospital, like 3 days or 4 days?
Sunday, went in. Bypass surgery on Monday, was home on Friday. It's unbelievable.
It's unbelievable, isn't it?
It is unbelievable. Believable. And the care that I received down there, and just, it's like what you said earlier, though. The cards, the phone calls, the text messages. People stopped me all over town, all still. Say, man, I was praying for you.
I prayed for you.
Well, I appreciate
Because I saw it online, you know.
Well, I mean, I'll tell you something. I'm talking about the love that I felt, and still. In this town, it's just the most unbelievable place for me because my son got married yesterday.
Yeah.
In Memphis. My youngest son, Riley. There you go. Pat Inslee, Janet, Mike, Judge Sharp, all of those guys come to Memphis.
You mean Mike Sharp and them went on to Memphis?
Absolutely. They can't, those people. Because my mom and dad have gone to be with the Lord. My brother.
That's a big deal for somebody to go all the way to Memphis from here.
Right.
For maybe a day thing or a day.
And you're thinking, here you have all these people from Cleveland come to Memphis to...
And it's not like you're going to entertain them while they're there.
No,
you're
to just, my son's wedding. Because what's happened in this town, the town has become my family. Many people in this town.
I think your dad created that long before. He was a well-liked person.
Right. My family now, Dee, is one of the longest tenured families at First Baptist Cleveland. I think that goes back to the 1800s.
I think Glenn Ramsey's the oldest.
Maybe Glenn.
Maybe him.
Glenn and my mother were so close. They all kind of grew up together. You know, my dad sold Glenn Ramsey one of his first tractors.
Is that right? You know, that Wednesday lunch they have is about the best deal in town.
Absolutely.
What is it, $6 or $4?
It's $7. And we have it at supper, too. Honestly, the craziest thing is, because of COVID, we just started doing it at supper at the end of the spring last year. And there was so many people coming. It was out the door. Bick and those guys do such a great job with that.
Oh, it's I think it's $6, and it's all you can eat, right. I guess. And no tip.
No.
You don't have to tip.
No.
Clean bathrooms.
Yes.
What else you want?
Good fellowship.
Yep. You can sit with anybody. It's just, you know, table of eight, whatever.
Absolutely.
Is that in the, that's in the summers only, right?
No, it starts in, it, it's the only time we don't do it, it's in the summer.
Okay,
summers.
I get it reversed.
It starts in August and goes through the school year.
Yeah.
Ends in May. And it's not happening in the summertime.
Now, do you now watch your diet, or why watch your diet if it was just genetic?
Because they said it's good for my bypasses to make sure I don't have any cholesterol. They watch me every 3 months.
So you have to go in every 3 months?
I do blood work every 3 months.
If you didn't have insurance, would they have just let you croak?
I'd have no idea.
Makes you wonder, doesn't it?
I'm just thankful I do have insurance. It's, but I don't know. I don't have a clue. I'm just thankful I do have insurance.
They didn't ask you when they wheeled you back if you had insurance, did they? Did they check that first?
I don't remember. I think Rachel must have talked to them about that. She probably did all those forms. They just wheeled me back.
So you work out now on a regular, every day, just like you were? Just what time of day do you go?
4:30. I'm going to tell you something interesting. Is it? My admin, you know Andy Williams? Andy Williams. Stevie Williams used to be the basketball coach of Bradley.
Oh, yeah, Stevie, yeah.
Stevie Williams, their family. Jackie Williams.
Yeah. Andy's like younger than me.
Yes. Well, his wife is my admin, Tammy. Great lady.
What's admin mean?
Administrative assistant. Okay. She's my secretary. Okay. And she has on my schedule at 4 o'clock, I try to rest for about 15 minutes. Shut my eyes. Nobody mess with me. 15 minutes.
In your office?
Wherever, just leave them alone for 15 minutes. I rest, and about 4:30, I go work out. Just kind of self-focus for the day, chill out, because I'm having calls and people see me all the time.
Monday through Friday?
Monday, exercise about 6 days a week. But at the office, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, sometimes on Friday and Sunday. Usually Friday afternoon and Saturday, no. I don't.
But you work out on Sundays too?
It depends if I've worked out on Saturday or not.
Where would you work out then?
YMCA.
So you go to the Y too?
YMCA, Judge Sharp and I work out about every day at the same time. Judge Sharp and I talk and ride a bike about every day about 4:30 or 5 at the YMCA.
Now he wears earplugs and he didn't do much talking.
No, not even. I wear earplugs, but when I'm riding beside him, we talk and we'll wear earplugs or talk. And what's the subject of the day? Gas prices. You know, we're talking about, you know.
So y'all are running on the treadmill?
No, we're riding a bike.
Okay.
And then I go in, stretch, treadmill, bike. And he's working out with weights. I don't do that weights anymore right now because I won't make.
Yeah.
That's my chest.
Yeah.
And then, so I'll ride on a treadmill while he's doing weights. And then he and I both will get on the bike about the same time.
About, 5:15 or something?
About 30 minutes.
You take a shower there before you go home?
He does. Because Judge Sharp, you know, he dresses the night. Yeah. I don't. I go on home. And usually, if I don't go home to pick up Rachel, I'll meet her at Lee to go for a walk then.
At 6-ish?
Mm-hmm. Go for a walk around Lee University. And
hour?
2.5 miles. We have this little 2.5 mile.
How far
mile
is
walk.
That? How far a walk is that?
You go, start at the softball field at Lee, go down to Inman, turn right, go down Okoy, go all the way down towards the softball field and turn back into that park right there.
How long does it take you?
40 minutes.
Why do you do that every day with her?
Just to decompress. Talk about stuff. You know, it goes back to what you and I talked about earlier, what my dad taught me is a lot. Communication is listening as much as it is talking. And so sometimes my wife wants to talk. She's been doing things all day and she wants me to listen. And it's a good conversation that I can listen to her, what's important to her today. And then I can get her advice on things, Rachel. What do you think about this? Because she knows me. What's your advice on these decisions? Probably not church, because I don't try to bring her into church decisions, but just other things. What do you think about this? She's a smart lady.
So about an hour?
Yes, sir.
You ever have to miss it?
Try not to.
Very rarely?
Yeah, very rarely. We walk sometimes with the Wallaces. You know Ken Wallace? He was a Bradley. He's about a little younger than you.
So they meet there at the same time?
Yes, sir. You know, Ken Wallace played center.
I don't think I know.
Remember Richie Hughes?
Yeah, yeah.
He was right after Richie and John playing center right there. So he must have been right after you. He had a sister named Karen, got killed in a car wreck, graduated with me at Bradley.
Seems like I remember that. But I can't place him.
Big guy. But we walked together some.
If you want residential or commercial plumbing, give Rick's Plumbing a call. Call Jason or Josh. They'll do you a good job. I use them. I've used them for years. They're no problem.
I'm Church of Christ, you're First Baptist, somebody else is Church of God, somebody's... Is there a big difference in who's going to be in heaven?
You know what? That's a great question. I think if I put my faith and trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, and He is the Lord of my life...
Then whether... Everything else is just kind of the way we understand it.
Yes. And you and I go out here and look at an accident, the same accident, and you might view it this way, I might view it this way, and he might view it another way, but we're looking at the same accident. I think if you have a relationship with Jesus and trust Him as your, put your total trust and faith in Him, I think the scripture says you're going to be saved. That's, it's going to be okay.
Now, when you've had those experiences, you don't question God anymore, do you? Like you had with the heart attack. Is your faith better now than it was then or about the same?
You keep, you know Alan Larkman? You ever heard Alan Larkman? He and I talk all the time. I was the first staff person he hired when he came here the first time. And then I was the last staff person he hired this time. He and I are great friends. He said, Jeff, you know, this has really changed you emotionally. Because I cry all the time. My wife said, I've cried more after this surgery than I have all 34 years of marriage combined. Because it just, for something that has your heart surgery deal with mortality, I think it brings out your emotions. And it's made me more sensitive to the Lord, and it's made me more sensitive to others, I believe. No, I don't believe, I know it has. And because I've been way blessed, and I think when you've been way blessed by the Lord, you want to look at others a little differently. And so my prayer is that I look at people to care and love them and encourage them, like the Lord has cared and loved on me. So,
but if we're supposed to bring people to the Lord, about everybody in America knows about Him. So how can we improve on that?
Well, that's the key. I don't think everybody knows the Lord or everybody wants to know the Lord. Especially, you know, you look at the amount of people now that don't know the Lord, or agnostics, or atheists, or they don't go to church. The percentage of people that are going to church, not the church saves you, but a relationship with Christ saves you. But because I have a relationship with Christ, I would want to worship with other people that are believers, which kind of encourage each other. It's a benefit of a fellowship with each other. And I think what has happened is I think we have stopped. It's like I said a while ago, I think it's important for us to talk about the characteristics which made Cleveland great, I think. And then I think a lot of times we've stopped telling about what is important of our, in our life spiritually to the next generation. And so they're saying, you know, I don't see any different in your life because of Christ. Why would I want Christ in my life? And you look at our world right now, deep, that's one. Mm.
It's just screwed up. I don't even know what to think. I don't even know what to think. You know, this COVID's about done away with Sunday night church, hadn't it?
It's the craziest thing. I was talking.
We'd be in church on right now if we were.
Totally.
20 years.
I'm getting ready to go to youth camp, though, so I got to.
But that's kids. A little bit different than Sunday night.
Yes, sir.
Sunday
yes.
night choir and like his talk.
We don't. Yeah, that those type of things. It's interesting because now when we go back and have fellowships in Sunday night church, it's interesting how many people at First Baptist Church we've been having on Sunday evening when we have those type of things. We had a fellowship here a while back, just several weeks ago, and it was 1,500 people show up.
Is that right?
Because they were looking for something to do with a family. It was important to them.
Sunday night church.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And I think.
How many did First Baptist have when you was a teenager there?
Well, I think Gene Mims, when he was the pastor there, when I was, they had Marvin and then had Gene. Mm-hmm. I think there was around 900 to 1,000 people at church. Now the church has 3,000 to 3,600 on a Sunday. I think it grew a lot when it moved out here on the north side of town for some reason. I don't know why.
I don't know why that would make it change, but it did.
It did. I think it more room. It could grow. I think so. And so... but you know, I think in our community, what I'm seeing now is kind of a resurgence of going to church. I think COVID, in a weird, interesting way, was people, because they did church online or different things, they didn't come in the building. I think now a lot of people that are coming back, they missed that fellowship so much. Not getting back together, man, it meant something different because they didn't have it for a little while.
And they don't have to. Everybody knows how to get online now.
Totally.
So it's an option.
Yes, sir. But you kind of sense a more of a zeal. Hey, we'll get to hang out together and talk to each other and look at each other in the face and then have the mask on and those type of things. So it's, I'm seeing, and maybe, yeah, it's interesting. Maybe it's, I'm different. Because I love...
Very possible. It could be looking at things different.
And because I like you and I are talking right here, I love this. It's something because...
Can't get enough of it,
it's
man.
A kindred spirit and...
It really is.
And...
We could just sit here really and not even talk and I'd be just as... I'm good.
You and I were in a meeting. Now I won't talk about the meeting. You and I are in a meeting, and how much did I say in that meeting?
Not a word. I might have said too much. I don't
know. No, you're fine. But in the meeting, I didn't say a word. Mm-hmm. Now, I could have said a lot. And here's what I did. I just sat there and listened, and I watched the interaction. And I knew what was happening. I knew what was happening when it was happening, but mm-hmm. I just let it happen. Mm-hmm. And then after the meeting, you stood up. And I said, how you doing, brother? And you said, I'll quote you, how's John? And everybody in the room looked at him and said, well, they do they know each other? And I said, after you walked, I said, we've known each other all of our lives.
You know, when you called me later, I don't know. It's just, you just can't replace that stuff. And well, you can't describe it.
No. And you and I can be in a room, don't have to say anything to each other. But no.
We're on the same. If it goes down, I know who we're with.
Yeah.
That's what you look
that's
at.
Exactly. Isn't it? Well, I don't have to look around me to know who's going to be beside me.
If it all comes down, you know.
Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense.
When you have to look around and say, are they going to be around? I'm like, well, they weren't ready to begin with. You know what I'm saying? So I don't. I, and a couple of guys in the meeting looked at me and said, I didn't realize you knew me. I said, all of our lives. I said, we've known each other. I said, what people don't understand sometimes, because a lot of people that weren't necessarily from Cleveland.
Right. They don't understand that.
And I was gone and then came back. But really, I never really left here. I'm from.
Yeah. John could come in here and. It's just, you just can't put your finger on it. People don't get it.
No.
That aren't from here.
It's like driving. When I would come back after I left, my kids are not from here. Two of them were born here, but they weren't from, you know, they grew up basically in Nashville as a whole. They said, Dad, do we have to drive around Cleveland all the time when you come home and you tell us all the things that happened? You know, go to the Red Bull or go to ice cream, you know, over to Watson's food store, go to Old Bradley, go down by Bishop's Bakery, go across the railroad tracks where you don't probably remember Dooley's ice cream plant.
Oh, yeah, I remember.
You know, that's my uncle.
Oh, is that right?
Uncle Bill Dooley.
I had Fox. Actually, I don't know him. What's Randy Fox?
Yeah,
I had him on there. He spent all his youth at Dooley's ice cream.
That's my uncle.
Is that
my
right?
My great-grandmother lived across the street there. That's why I tell you, my family been here forever. On Centenary Boulevard, all those families, the Sugars, the Rides, the O'Neills, the Reimers, that's my family. That's my mother's side of the family.
So your uncle,
Uncle Bill Dooley,
had Dooley's ice cream?
Yes, sir. You know the Dooley Street right there?
That would have been your dad's? No.
My mother's uncle. That's my great uncle.
Okay, here we go.
Now that, my mother. See, my mother's family is here longer than my dad's family. My dad's family is basically from Polk County. But my mother's family is here forever. I mean, a long tenured family.
What's his family? Did he go to Polk County High School, Rick?
No, he went to Bradley. But they grew up in
Polk County.
Yes, sir. Grew up in Polk County.
Let me tell you an interesting story. I went to, going to build this building in Chattanooga, big doctor's building. And I had a pre-construction meeting. I didn't know what it was. I went in there with my short pants and I was just acting normal. And it was a big to-do, man.
Right.
They had all the departments, 12 departments there. And I was supposed to tell them everything we was going to do. And I hadn't even looked at the plan.
How in the world did you get in that situation?
Well, I didn't know that it was so formal.
Right.
So I go in, I sit down, and they're starting to ask me questions. I had literally not looked at the plans because I was going to build it anyway. I just hadn't got to it.
Right.
So they're all starting to really kind of give me, because I was from out of town and everything. So a guy walks by, and I just saw the silhouette, and I saw him back up because there's a glass window. And he said, hey, D, he said, come in here and see me in a minute before you leave. And I didn't even see him. I said, oh, okay. And I said, who was that? And they said, that was Tony Kinder. And I said, was that Tony Kinder? And I said, yeah. He said, yeah. And I said, what's he doing? He said, he's over this entire thing. I was there 20 more minutes. I had the building permit, and I was sitting in their boss's office drinking a cup of coffee. So that's what we were talking about.
Unbelievable. How in the world did you get in the building business?
I've done this since I was 12, 13 years old.
But you really, when I came back here a couple of times, even with youth minister in the middle, in the 95, 96, 97, and I come back this time, I keep hearing your name everywhere.
I built a bunch, and more like, so then.
And I'm like, the same D that I know? and I'm like, well, they started to describe me. I said, I've been knowing him all my life. And everywhere I go, I hear your name as far as building and excavation, all that stuff.
What if it's construction or real estate, I'm usually involved in it on some level.
But let me ask you this. The future's bright, isn't it?
Yes.
We've got another, what, 40 years left?
Me?
Sure.
I'm 58.
You'll just be 98.
You know what?
People are living longer.
They are.
You can't have a heart attack.
I'm going to tell you this, though. My goal is live today like it's my last. I'm going to live today to its fullest. I'm not promised tomorrow. Yesterday's gone. Let's live wide open today.
What's your favorite church song?
I need the every hour right now. Because what happens...
Most precious Lord.
My Savior. Here's what... Because it shows independence in God, realizing I can't do it, but He can through me. And so if I show a dependence in the Lord, I realize who's in charge today.
Have you noticed that a lot of the more religious people have the least faith? Something I've noticed.
You know, I'm going to tell you why, in my opinion. That's a great word. Religious people are about doing. Let's do this. And I'm really about being. Out of a healthy being, then my doing will be healthy. But in my being, I'm dependent on God to do something in me. And then He does the doing through me, not Jeff Lovingood. A lot of times our religious people want to say, look what we did. We've done this. We've gone to church. We've read the Bible.
Like the Sadducees.
Pharisees. Yeah, absolutely.
Pharisees.
Yes.
Or Sadducees.
Pharisees. Sadducees were liberal. I mean,
They were Sadducees.
Sadducees, yeah. But the deal is, I want to, out of a healthy being and a dependence on the Lord to work through me, oh my goodness, look what happens. But if it's all about me doing, then it's all about Jeff Lovingood. Look, man, you know what the fact of it is? I couldn't operate it on my heart.
It'd been...
But you know what? God gifted those doctors and nurses in such a way that He operated on my heart through those people.
I have a feeling God was going to take care of you.
Absolutely.
God has more control in our daily lives than we ever would imagine, doesn't He?
That's why you got to be dependent in Him, not in self. Our society is so lonely, hurting because of the dependence in self. And God said, man, I want to be with you. I want to know you. I want to hang out with you so you can't be lonely. If you just depend on me, I'll be with you. I'm never going to leave you or forsake you. Oh, my stars, D. When you're having an open heart surgery, they give you a 30% chance to live. I'm not going to leave you or forsake you.
Your dad had died of it.
Listen to me.
What were your odds?
If I die, I'm going to go to heaven. If I live, I'm going to see my family. But in a minute, we'll all be in heaven. Because you think about it. You're on earth but a vapor. Eternity's forever. But unfortunately, we live life like we're on earth forever and be in heaven in a vapor. But it's the opposite.
Yeah.
It's like Kenny Chesney sings that song. Everybody wants to go to heaven, but they don't want to go right now. You know what I'm saying? But we're all, if we know Christ, we'll go to heaven. But the fact of it is, that's eternity. But we, David Landeth, my best friend over there in Long Hollow, died of cancer. Lynn Ramsey's son-in-law. I looked at him right before he died. He said, I'll see you in a minute. I'll see you in a minute.
Was he sick, real sickly then?
He went from 6'6", basically 240 to 6'6", 145. Cancer is just terrible. But I'm telling you something, what I learned from him, which helped me through my heart attack. He taught me how to die well. Not just live well, but to die well.
And he was a man's man, wasn't he?
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. I'm talking about unbelievable man's man. He's a guy you and I mean, you hang out with each other.
Everybody loved him.
Man. Oh, my stars. He'd come to my office. He'd look at me and say, Lovingood, we need to go get a pick-me-up. I said, okay. And a pick-me-up to him would go, let's go get a dip cone.
One dip.
Yeah, maybe the big chocolate, big chocolate, big dip. Remember, that's where I used to look at the Dairy Queen down in South End of town.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Foot-long hot dog with chili, cheese, and chopped up onions, and then get me a big drink and a dip cone at the end. That was my pregame meal at Bradley High School. That's my pregame meal at Bradley
High bread. Yes. Thick bread.
Yes.
Dairy Queen.
Brother,
man.
Listen.
Thanks for coming.
Anytime.